know, he's just right there for us all the time, and I'm so thankful for the Lord. I just love him.
Amen, amen. Someone else this morning. Someone else. Someone else. How about someone with a special song this morning? Or maybe a testimony. Everybody seems like they're a little down this morning, folks. Don't get down. This world could get you down. Let's get up this morning and praise our Heavenly Father. Amen. Remember all those that's battling the COVID this morning. I understand we had some prayer requests this week of some people in very serious condition. But remember those folks this morning, that God will be merciful to them and help them through this troublesome time that we're going in. Like, as I say, remember Sister Connie this morning as she's down and with a sickness this morning. I told Brother Jim, I think it's the first Sunday she's ever missed. I can't remember that lady ever missing church. She's very faithful. But lift her up this morning. Sister Angie's going to come and sing for us this morning. And while she's coming, be much prayer for her. She'll have to go back to work next week, maybe, if the school opens back up. And I know it's a very fulfilling job she's got, but it's very taskful too. So remember her as we pray this morning.
You know, it amazes me sometimes how good the Lord is to us, and we're so undeserving, but he chooses to bless us anyway, and I love him. So just pray for me while I get through this one. I've always had a place to sleep, clothes to wear and food to eat. God has been so Amen. Good to me. Amen. I thank you, Lord, for mom and dad, the best friends on earth I've had. God has been so good to me. God has been so good to me. I'm thankful for a fine family, the little church that I attend, and for all my Christian friends. God has been so good to me. Thank God I live where men are free, where there's love and liberty. God has been so good to me. If all I had he took away, then I still would have to say, God has been so good to me.
Amen.
God has been so good to me. I'm thankful for a fine family, the little church that I attend, and for all my Christian friends. God has been so good to me. Thankful this morning.
Amen.
And, I was thinking on our way here, the oldest grandson, when she was carrying him, she kind of ran into some trouble with him and went to the hospital just for an appointment one day and then came home with him. When she was there in the hospital and some things were just not going well and some things were really scary for a while, and that song, and I can't even think of the line, the exact line of it, but there's power in prayer, and when it talks about the grandfather in the corner praying, and everything was just all happening so fast, and it seemed like I could just hear something different in the room, and Papa was praying, and
Amen.
Amen.
And you can see everything turned out fine.
Sure.
And I'm just so thankful, like Mom said, that we have someone that we can go to anytime and know that He hears and answers our prayers.
Sure. Amen. Amen. Bless your heart. Someone else with a testimony while Sister Debbie's coming this morning. Anybody else? If not, be much in prayer for our little girl this morning as she sings for us.
A long time since I've been that, Charlie.
You'll still be my little girl.
I'm thankful to be here this morning, and just like what everybody else has said, God's been so good to me. And I sit and think about what so many people are going through, so many in our community and so many of our friends and loved ones that have faced battles, and I'm just thankful that no matter what we face, that He can handle it. Problem, it's no longer up to you. You pray the prayer of faith, you're standing on God's truth. While you're waiting on the answer, He has a question for you.
Someone else this morning. You got a song this morning, Jim? Someone else this morning. Don't want to leave anybody out of this service this morning. This is not my service. This is God's service this morning. Bless you, Jim.
You know, I don't know if you heard, anybody listened to Calvary Evan this morning? Yeah, and you know, the Word of God is so powerful, and the Word of God is so important in our services, in any service, but the Word of God means everything, and it should be spoken, and it should be preached and taught in every service we have. But he also mentioned today that the instruments that God, you know, some people don't, some churches don't believe in the instruments, but instruments are a powerful use.
Yes.
Especially if they're anointed people that are playing those instruments for God and in a service. And the Spirit of God will move as we allow it to move, as we allow Him to move. And if we don't open our hearts, and if we don't come, you know, even when we're down, we're sick, we're not unable to utter hardly a word, God knows our hearts. And if we just attempt to open up our hearts and our mouths and praise Him, He will honor that.
Sure.
And He will honor people. And God will show up in every service if we do that. So I love Him this morning. I just want people to know that I love Him. I love the people here.
Bless you, brother.
And I just want to say that.
Bless you, brother. Amen. Amen. Someone else while they're coming this morning. Anybody else? Well, we're certainly thankful for these folks this morning and ask God to richly bless them as they sing this morning.
Time in the modern history of the church that people need to just press out and go, and it's the day that we're living in. We absolutely need the fellowship of the believers.
That's right.
Yeah. We need to hear the word.
That's right.
And it's not that listening to TV, it's not that it's wrong or that it's bad, because it's not, it's good. But just something about joining together in God's house with the fellow believers, and just being able, even though we don't hug anymore. I'm a hugger. Before all this, I'd see you in Walmart and I'd just hug you. I didn't care. But we need to get back to that old path, as Jeremiah said. Seek out the old path. When you find it, walk therein, you shall find rest. But I love the Lord, just glad that He saved me. I'm not perfect. I wish I was. I think as long as we're here on this earth, we're not going to be perfect. But we do serve a perfect one. And there's always that old road that we need to walk in. I've been standing, looking down the narrow road, trying hard to find my way back home. Lord, and why I strayed so far, I'll never understand. But that same just seems longer when you've been so far from God. It'll lead back to the church where once I prayed, and to the altar where we met with God each day. Lord, and why I strayed so far, I'll never understand. But that same goal will lead me home again. Oh, that same goal will lead me back to Jesus. No matter my feet have trod, and there'll be road signs that'll point me back to Calvary. It just seems longer when you've been so far from God. It just seems longer when you've been so far from God.
Sin to come short of the glory of God, and I think we kind of get it in our mind that that's just exclusively to the lost people that's out there in this world. It's never went to God, never repented of their sins. It's never been saved. But folks, that's each and every one of us.
Yep.
The Bible declares that we're sinners. Not
that's right.
You know, we don't we're not sinners because we sin, but you know, we sin because we are sinners, and that's and we was just born into it. It's inherent. Even so, that's even more so why we need to cling to Him. Just hold on, and He is always that old path. He's always that shore, that solid rock, that foundation. Thank God that we can go to. But I just love Him, and I'm glad. I haven't always been perfect, but I'm always directed back by His Spirit.
Amen.
This is what you need to do. This is where you need to go. Folks, I don't know what I'd do without Him in this day we're living.
Right.
Bless you, brother.
I tell you, I really wouldn't. And heaven's just looking sweeter each and every day. Thank God. I love Him.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Anyone else this morning? You going to take the kids downstairs?
I just want to stay and say how much I love God this morning. I had a really bad day yesterday, and I had to pray really hard last night. And then this morning I got up at 7:30, and I looked outside, and I thought, well, you know, the roads are clear. I can go to church. And Dad was like, well, it's cold out. And then I come to thinking, you know, I get up 5 days a week in the cold, go to work.
Amen. Bless you, sis. Bless your heart.
So, just pray for me.
Amen.
Bless you, dear. Anyone else? This is something I've been looking forward to for several Sundays. We're going to dismiss the kids down to Children's Church at this time. And our pastor with this morning's message, Brother George.
Good place to be, huh?
Amen.
For those of you that remember Don Ellis, he would always say he'd rather be here than the best jail in Scioto County. So, rather be here than a lot of places. This is a good place to be. E flat. Lock me up in a prison and throw away the key. Take away the vision. from these eyes that now can see. Deprive me of the food I eat, and even bind my hands and feet. But as long as I know Jesus, then I can still go free. That I could still go free. What kind of man would reach down his hand and do this for me? Not fit to kill, than a man on the cross puts me in his will and says that I could still go free. Well, I never could quite understand why a king would want to leave his throne to don the robe of an earthly man, feel the pain of flesh and bone, then to later trod the lonely path that led to Calvary, where the blood red stains they broke all of the chains, that I could still go free, that I could still go free. What kind of man would reach down his hand and do this for me? Oh, unworthy to live and not fit to kill, than a man on the cross puts me in his will and says that I could still go free.
You know the needs, God, and I pray that you would bless, Lord, encourage her, give her help, give her strength, Lord, whatever the need may be, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you will bless her if this day is not better. Help her to see better days are coming.
the book of Acts this morning, chapter 12 of the book of Acts. Amen. It is good to have you this morning. That's for sure. Chapter 12 of the book of Acts. You may have heard some of this before from me here, but we will never meet again like this, no doubt. So I won't tell you that I haven't done something and then done it again, but I remember the first time that I changed a message on my own. I was in the church ready to preach. I wasn't a pastor at the time. I was attending Community Bible Church, and so it was my night to preach, and I saw this fellow walk in that I knew was not a Christian, and I'd went to school with him in high school, and here it had been about 10 years, and I saw him, and automatically I wanted to pick something that would just reach him. That's the wrong thing to do, because if God's given you the message, if his message can't reach him, ain't nothing going to reach him. So I tried to learn from that. And this morning I come with this message, and I'm just, it's good to know. I want you all to know this, that when I come to preach, I don't come to preach your business. I don't sit and wait for the songs to get sang so I'll know what to preach, and I don't listen to the conversation so I'll know where to hit you. This is just God's word, and it is good for all of us. Today I do like those songs the sister played for us. I do appreciate you playing this morning, but I do like what a friend we have in Jesus and living by faith. Living by faith just makes you a liar. If you sit there in the pew and sing that song and you really aren't living by faith, it just makes you. This hymn book right here alone will make you a liar if you're not careful. Sunday morning you come in, you're not really into it much, you know, and I will follow where he leadeth. You barely followed to get to church. What do you mean you'll follow? So you had to be careful, but there's some good songs in there. And those songs go along, written properly, go along with the Word of God and the things that we find here. So chapter 12 of the book of Acts. The first part of this is always something that this is an in general statement probably, but people have a problem with what we see in the first part of the book of Acts in chapter 12. I'll explain that in a minute. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also, and then were the days of unleavened bread. And when they had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quatrains of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. So we got these soldiers, 16 men in six-hour shifts, watching him to make sure he doesn't get away. But the thing I said that, and in general statement, is that some folks find difficult to handle is that, what's the difference between James and Peter? James is killed by the sword. So what do? We say, sorry about your luck. I mean, can you imagine going back to James's family, knocking on the door and saying to them, your husband or your father has been killed by Herod. God allowed it. And oh, by the way, Peter was put in prison, but God broke him out. It's like today, you know, you hear when our prayer chain comes through, I pray for everybody that's on the prayer chain. And as it comes through, sometimes I cringe because I think to myself, this may not be what we would consider to be a simple prayer or an easy prayer. This may be an announcement that someone has passed. Pray for the family. And especially in the time that we see around us, we know just in this past week there are folks that have died and there are going to be funeral services for them. And then there are other folks that just continue like we are here today. We're just going on. We're just living. We could say, well, it wasn't our time yet. Well, believe me, I don't know when your time is or my time is, but I do know you got a time and I got a time. And one day, if they write it, it will be you in the obituaries. Probably 25 years ago, I wrote my own obituary. How nice is that? And I preached my own funeral at the church I was pastoring. And if I could have, I'd have had William McKinley bring a casket and stick it up front just for more of an impact to the people. But what I was trying to say to them was that we're all going to die, and all the accolades you have aren't going to mean much of anything to people here, let alone they won't mean anything to God. The only thing that will mean anything to God is what you did with his son. And that sounds cruel and it sounds rough because we try to better ourselves and make ourselves something maybe in our community or in our families. And I'm not saying that trying to be a good person or trying to do right won't get you anywhere. Your family may be thankful for everything in your obituary, everything you've done. But when you stand before God, it's going to be, what did you do with his son? But we're all going to die. And for James to be killed like this, this wasn't just a spur of the moment thing. God saw this coming like he sees everything else coming. And I would like to think that James was prepared if he was going to die today or if he was going to die 10 years from now. And that's the good thing about us today. I would like to say that all of us can be prepared that if we're going to pass today, or we're going to pass 5 years from now, we are born-again believers, and if that is our time to go, no one has to sit and wonder, I wonder where George is today. I wonder what Ron is experiencing today. And so it's important for us to be ready at all times. But James is killed. They've taken Peter. They're proposing this feast day's coming after Easter, that they're going to kill him because Herod has seen that it has pleased the Jews. We read the history of what's happened with Christ. And so as these men now, disciples, now apostles, they are still on the run and preaching the word of God as they go. And that's why Peter's being locked up in the first place. And so it says in verse 5, Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. Isn't that nice? You know, I can't think of anything nicer than meeting someone, talking with them. And I've got two or three people that have said this to me in my lifetime. Maybe more people do it, but this is always nice when you hear it. It always touches me to hear someone say, I call your name every day in prayer. I don't know if anybody's ever told you that. But when you got people that are almost twice your age, I'm 53, almost twice your age, that will look you in the eye and say, Brother George, I call your name every day, every morning in prayer. That does something to me. That's touching to me, that somebody cares enough about me and about my wife and about our family to call, not just to say, pray for so-and-so, a blanket prayer before we fall asleep, you know, before the blanket's up over us, just a blanket prayer for everyone. God bless the church. Does it happen sometimes? Sometimes it does. I used to have a friend. He was 94. He was a World War II veteran. I'd go to visit him, and if I'd take him something to eat, he lived alone, and he'd be watching Western so loud that the whole community could hear him. You know, they'd probably think he was having people shooting at him in his own house with the gunshot fires. But I'd take him something to eat. And barely over top of the Westerns, you would hear him say, God, thank you for the food, while he was putting it in his mouth. Some people would condemn him or criticize him, but that's what he's doing. He's thanking God for the food. And he was hungry, so he was getting it in as fast as he could get it in. How we pray, we could take a lesson from these folks. Verse 5 says, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. So they're praying. It's been said that they're maybe having a prayer meeting, but they're down the road, the scripture tells us, at the house of John Mark's mother, Mary, and they're down the road praying for Peter. So it's good to know that someone's praying. Now let's look at the other perspective of what's happening with the person that's being prayed for. And when Herod would have brought him forth, this is verse 6, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. I mean, I'm telling you what, this would be like the most wanted. I mean, whatever you do, don't let him get away. You already see what's happened with this one they call Jesus, and that's why this whole mess has started in the first place, is because they took his body. Now, I'm just saying, this is what the people who did not believe that Jesus had raised from the dead would be saying. We already see that they took his body and they hid it, and now it started this whole movement of this Savior that has risen, this Messiah, and so whatever you do, don't you let him get away. 16 men in 6-hour shifts. Peter is asleep between two soldiers, chained. A man at the door waiting. Keepers before the door of the prison. Verse 7, and behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison. And he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise quickly, and his chains fell off from his hands. That's why I sang that song, that I could still go free. No matter what you would do to me today, as long as I have Jesus Christ in my heart, I could still be free. I don't know if you know, some of you folks probably would. There's a contemporary Christian artist who now is an old guy compared to that style of music, but he was one of the forerunners maybe, Stephen Curtis Chapman, and he would go into the prison system. And so he went into the prison system. His name slips me now, but it was somebody that had been in Ronald Reagan or in Nixon's cabinet, and he ended up getting caught and going to prison as well. And when he came out, he was converted, and this man has a prison ministry. And so he took Stephen Curtis Chapman in with him. And as they went in and was ministering to people, this fella came over and got to talking to Chapman. And as he was talking, he described, and if you've never heard the song, and I attempt to sing it sometimes, not very well, but man, it's a song that just moves me when I hear it, because he's sitting there talking to this man that is on death row. And he has the permission to be there and talking with him. And this man says, I'm here, and I did what they accused me of doing. I'm here. But he says, although I'm locked up, I'm free. And the reason he's free is he'll never get out of that prison, but he's free because he has Jesus Christ living inside. And so here is Peter locked up, two guards, one on either side, keepers of the prison door out front. And the angel comes to him and taps him on the side and raised him up, saying, arise quickly, and his chains fell off from his hands. And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he saith unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me. I got that circled. What did Jesus say when he came to Peter? When he looked at Peter, he said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So the way hasn't stopped just because Jesus has went away. When he sends someone to take care of you, it's the same direction. Follow him. And so the angel says to him, follow me. And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought that he saw a vision. Have you ever had something happen to you? I guess nowadays the word would be surreal. Have you ever had something happen that you almost can't believe that it's happened or it is even happening? Could you imagine? I can't, but could you imagine being locked up in a prison and in this situation and then your chains dropping off and here you are and you're standing now outside and he thinks he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth into the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him. And when Peter was come to himself, have you ever done that? Have you ever come to yourself? Teresa and I were talking about this just in the last 2 weeks. We've seen something and we've shared it with the church while we weren't on camera, but it's almost like the prodigal son being at the pig pen and all of a sudden he comes to himself. There is something. I'm starving to death here and there is food enough and to spare back home. And that my father's servants have a place to lay their head. They have enough food to eat and they're being taken care of. And here I am living like a bum, a beggar. And so he came to himself and he went back. I really believe with all my heart, folks, until the person comes to themselves, you can talk till you're blue in the face. The old saying is, you can talk and when you're a parent, you will talk. You will still try. And I can't tell you how difficult it is for me to shut my mouth because I have an opinion and God knows I'm right. I thought y'all would get that. Are you laughing underneath? No. Okay. But when it's family, sometimes you back away and you just have to give it to God. Well, what are these other people? They're over here praying. Here they are praying. I don't know how they prayed. Maybe they did you see the Jews at the Wailing Wall over there. Maybe that's how they prayed. Maybe they were on their knees. Maybe they were holding hands. I don't know what they were doing, but I know that prayer was made without ceasing for Peter. And so now Peter, here he is. He was come to himself. He said, I know of a surety that the Lord hath sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. At this time right here, Peter ain't going to die. God's not going to deliver him from that prison so now he can go for another day or two and then get his head chopped off. He's not dying. He's got work to do, and that's why God brought him out of the prison. And that's what I said here a while back. If you had COVID, for those people that in here that have had COVID, and it's the dreaded disease, the people around you mention that, and people automatically think you're going to die if you got that disease. Now, I'm not making light of it or making fun of it, but whenever I was told that I had it, I had phone calls from a man in Columbus, from a man out of Chillicothe, from another local man, and I told Teresa when I got off the phone with them, I didn't feel like talking. I don't talk to them a whole lot, but I had an idea. They were calling me to tell me goodbye because I could hear it in their voice. They were afraid of what was going to happen. I said, God didn't bring Peter out of that prison to kill him, to let him die in 2 or 3 days. So Peter had a job to do. And that's why God delivered him. So I'm saying to you, that's why God has delivered you. If you were done, God might have went on and took you. You say, well, what does that say about anybody else? I can't speak for the people who are gone. I can't speak for why James died and why Peter didn't. I don't know. But I'm saying if God has blessed you and you are here, praise the Lord. Give him praise. Give him glory. Be able to witness. Do what maybe you didn't do strong enough before. Just do it. And so here, Peter's like, well, I thought this was a vision, but this is real. Verse 12, and when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. And when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness. that's Peter. So she was so excited, she runs back, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. And isn't it funny? You know what the people said that were there having the prayer meeting? You're crazy. You're mad. They said unto her, thou art mad. But she constantly affirmed that it was even so. And they said, it is his angel. But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Can you imagine? Here's Peter like, I know she heard me. She goes back and the people think she's crazy. For those of you who are praying and feeling like you're not seeing anything happen, and then when something does happen, trying to believe what you're seeing. Teresa and I, the last 2 weeks, we are there with you. We have seen that. such a change. So it's no different what we're seeing in the last couple of weeks than these people seeing Peter, who was in prison standing at the door. It's no different in our lives. What we prayed for almost 4 years, now boom, all of a sudden in our family we're seeing it happen. And I can only stand back. I'm going to tell you something. I don't go to bed anymore wondering if my daughter's all right. I don't go to bed anymore wondering and worrying about certain things. You say, you're a preacher, you're a pastor, you shouldn't be that way. Well, you just deal with it when it comes your way. But let me tell you, when it's your daughter, when it's your family, when it's your loved one, you will feel a little different. And the nights that I would pray, and Teresa would say, you're not even in the bed with me. I wake up and you're just not even there. I just would get up and I would sit down sometimes in the living room. And I would say, God, as much as I can, I'm laying this in your hands, but I don't know what else to do. And the dad in me wanted to be the fixer. I wanted to go and do everything that was needed to straighten her life out, but I couldn't. But God could. And the whole time that I'm praying, God is coming in, breaking the chains, leading her out. And when I hear that, I'm thinking, really? When Teresa calls me one day, 2 weeks ago, and says, my words, starting the conversation, don't you love to hear this? Someone calls you. I said, what's wrong? She said, nothing's wrong. Something is right. And she started telling me. And I think I was shocked. I was just like, I just sat there in my car and I thought, am I hearing what she is saying? Why, Wayne? I prayed for it for 4 years. Was it a fake prayer? No. Was it prayer was made for Peter daily without ceasing? I prayed daily for this. Amen. But when it happened, was it a shock? Yes. What am I saying to you? Keep on praying. Keep on praying. What a friend we have in Jesus. Living by faith. Is there anything too hard for God? Even our songs today have said, don't lose faith. Keep on praying. So finally they go and they open the door. They knew that the voice was Peter's and he continued knocking. And they opened the door. But he beckoning to them with a hand told them to hold their peace, declaring to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, go show these things unto James and to the brethren. And he departed and went into another place. Next thing I'm waiting for is for the story to be shared by the person who has been released. I can share it as being one that was in the prayer meeting and say, you ain't gonna believe this, but we prayed and prayed and prayed, and this happened. But it was different when Peter went and shared it after that, and I believe that he had to. When he said, you know, I was even in prison and the angels came and the chains just dropped and he led me out and the iron gate just opened of its own accord. And somebody's probably saying, this guy's nuts. But there he was. So my prayer is now, and I woke up this morning thinking about it, my prayer is now that the chains in our family situation that have been broken, and Teresa and I who have been in the, and other people, and you with us if you've been praying, I've been in the prayer meeting praying for this to happen and have stood and watched. Now my next prayer is from the mouth of the person that has been released, God, let that be a testimony to people around how God can move, because he can. Maybe you're here today and you got something happening in your life that you just think, I don't know how we're ever going to get through this. Some of you maybe have never been, you know what? Probably you all have been at one time or another in your life. Maybe you've all been financially strapped. Jimmy, you haven't always been wealthy. So maybe somewhere when you first got married, and Teresa and I first got married, no kids, not Christians. I remember I went up to visit my dad. I had been working at this place and lost my job, and here I am, 19 years old, and married to a 19-year-old. no job, it's Christmas time, feel like a bum. I go up to visit Mom and Dad, which lived right up behind us. We lived down in front of them in a little apartment, and went up to visit them. Before I left, my dad said, hey, there's a card in there for you from this little church. And he told me where the church was. And I remember taking that card and walking down the road to our apartment and opening the card. And I can't tell you what it said. It may have been an Easter card at Christmas time. I don't know. The only thing I saw was a $100 bill. And I've looked for those $100 bills every time I've opened a Christmas card since. I opened that card and that $100 bill was there. And you would have thought you'd given Teresa and I $1,000, $1,000,000. When you don't have nothing, anything is something. Amen. And I never forgot that. And every time we've ever had a chance to show someone our love to them and do it in a way that they won't have to remember who it came from, I remember who sent that card to us. But they didn't send it to us so they could get the glory out of it. They sent it to us for us. But if you've ever suffered financial strain and hardship, then you know what it's like to pray constantly, God, we need help. How about sickness? And talking about the two boys and their situations when they were born. I've told you this before, but I was standing in B&B Loan talking to a fella. This has been now a little over 10 years ago, but I'm standing in there talking to a fella, believe it or not, about a guitar. And as I have the guitar in my hands, my cell phone rings. I answer my cell phone. Teresa is crying on the other end. She's telling me that they have run a test on our little granddaughter, and she's got some internal problems going on, and they are taking her to Columbus. And the fella across the counter looked at me and he said, George, are you all right? And I handed the guitar back to him and I left. And I remember getting to our house, which was in Lucasville. Teresa came home from work. We met there together and we walked in and I said, Teresa, listen to me. I said, this is going to be a long ride for us to Columbus. I said, we don't understand what's happening. I said, but God knows everything that's happening. I said, so let's take time right now to start praying that God, whatever is going on with her, you already know what it is. We lay it in your hands. If it is something severe, if it is something that can be repaired, if it is something that's not even there, God, it's all up to you. We just lay it in your hands. Say, wow, George, you had a lot of faith. I was scared to death. We get to Columbus, we walk in, they won't allow us back. And I said, you know, I'm a hospice chaplain, I know regulations like that. I said, that's fine, we're going to be sitting right over here. We'll watch them if they come out, if they call for us and we're allowed. And the woman said, okay. And it wasn't 5 minutes. Out comes our son-in-law and our daughter and our granddaughter. And they started telling us, this was wrong, that test was wrong, everything's good, nothing is wrong. And my daughter said, those doctors that she started talking about, doctors running tests at the last hospital they were at, I said, you could just stop right now. I said, for all you know, she had the problem. And on the way to the hospital, God took care of it. But whatever it was, maybe you're there today. Maybe you feel so distraught. Maybe you're the one in prison like Peter. I won't tell you, Peter was tore up. He was sleeping. He was sleeping between these soldiers and they were all around and he was asleep. But I will tell you that God knows exactly where you are. If you're in the prayer meeting or if you're in the prison, he knows exactly where you are today. You say, I'd rather be in the prayer meeting. Well, you take whatever you are handed, I suppose. But either place you are today, God knows where you are. He knows your needs and he's there for you. Lord, I thank you for the day you've given us. God, I thank you for the opportunity to speak your word today. I pray, Lord, for encouragement, for strength, Lord, for those that are here today that have heard this message, this scripture. God, this is, we can look through your word and we can pick and think maybe this is right or this is right for today. God, I'm just thankful that you lay on our hearts what it needs to be said. And God, I pray that you would bless today. Help those that are here to realize that whether they are the ones in the prayer meeting or they are the ones in the prison, you know exactly where they are today. And God, I pray that you will give them the help they have need of. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. We're going to take a moment here. Ma'am, could you make your way down to the piano for us, please? Here she comes. She's going to play us a verse or two of an invitation song. Say, Brother George, it's hard to come to the altar and be 6 feet apart. We got a wide space here. If you need to pray, come and pray. Kneel at the pews up here if you need to, but this is an opportunity for you to pray this morning. As I am and waiting on to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come just as I am, without one plea but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve. Because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come.
Yes, Lord, as we come to you, we do pray for those that are here, Lord. God, that you will give them the help and the strength that they have need of, Lord. You know, dear God, all the things that they need of, Lord. You will bless her today. Yes, Lord. God, I pray for this, our brother, Lord. You know, dear God, his needs, Lord. And I pray, dear God, that you lift his spirit, Lord. Help him, dear God, to look to you for help, Lord, and all the things, dear God, that he has need of today, Lord. You know what they are, Lord. And I pray, dear God, that you will bless him. Give him help, Lord. Give him strength, Lord, and guidance, Lord. Pray, dear God, that you will bless, Lord, those situations in his life and his home, Lord, with his work, whatever they may be, Lord, however he feels today, God. I pray, Lord, that you will bless him to see whether he's in the prayer meeting or the prison today. Dear God, that you've got the answer for him. You know where he is, Lord. You can give him the help that he has need of, Lord. I pray, dear God, for a closer walk with you, Lord. That's something that we all can ask for, Lord, and seek, dear God. And I pray, Lord, for that today as well, Lord. Whatever the need is here, Lord, I pray, dear God, that you will bless. We love you, Lord, and we thank you, Lord. Bless, Lord. Help us, dear God. Give everything, Lord, holy to you. Father God, just remain, dear God, in the face of the adversity, dear God. Lord, we love you and praise you. God bless you, buddy.
Amen.
Yes, it is, Brother Rob. Sometimes we need to pray. Not that we don't have faith in God, but sometimes we question him why the thing is so long.
Right.
Because we live in a society we're all done right now.
Right.
But God does things in no time.
Yeah.
So we have to pray, God, give me the patience to wait on you.
Right.
Because you're working.
Yeah.
Not that it's our disbelief or our Satan tells us it's not going to do it for you, but look who you are.
Right.
But he will do it for us.
Right.
And I love him this morning. And I know he's going to work for
us. Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God.
I would never tell you don't pray the prayer of faith, but I will tell you when there's a room full of people who are praying without ceasing and don't have the faith that the answered prayer is right before them, I will tell you that God's going to answer if it's His will, whether you're praying or not, whether you're praying the prayer of faith or not. I do believe that prayer moves God, but sometimes I do believe that He sees us for who we are. He sees us with our lack of faith, just like He did when Christ was here and spoke with people. There are times that we just say, I don't know that that's going to happen. Somebody will say automatically, then if you don't believe it will, then it won't. I'm going to tell you, when it's God's will, it's going to happen. Whether you believe it will or not, when it's God's will, it will happen. It was God's will that Peter came out of that prison. And whether they believed he was out of it or not, it was God's will. He broke the chains. So it was His angel He sent that said, follow Me. So God is good to us for sure. All right, we have Sunday school immediately following this service. Brother Jimmy Dummett, are you preaching somewhere tonight? Brother Jimmy Dummett's preaching for us tonight. he gave the thumbs up, so that must be, he's like, okay. But please do pray for Ron and for Penny. Ron's got some condition with his back, and Penny needs our prayers as well. So, see ya.